Our final talk, Aurora, is going to give a presentation on Galina Balyshova, who was the main designer and main architect of the Soviet space program. Aurora, stage is yours.
Okay. Thank you all for coming here to this talk that was just scheduled yesterday, so I'm really surprised that so many people showed up. Just in case you're surprised, I gave exactly the same talk last year, and I'm just doing it again because people were asking me to do it again because it was on a stage at Chaos Zone and it was not recorded, so a lot of people were sad that they missed out and they wanted to see it again, so I'm just doing the same thing as last year, same procedure as every year. So the talk is about Galina Balyshova, who is an architect and who worked for the Soviet space program for close to 40 years and designed all the major space capsules and spacecrafts of the Soviet space program. And this is a quote by her. She says that space stations are, yes, architecture built amidst zero gravity. So I'm going to tell you a bit about her life, and then there's going to be like a lot of nice concept art of the spacecraft and some pictures of the finished products. Galina Balyshova has a very ordinary Russian life. She was born in the early 30s. Did I write it down? Yeah. To a aristocrat family that lost everything in the revolution. So she grew up in working class conditions, but because her father had a background in more classical literature and art, he sent her to painting lessons from a pretty young age. And while she learned to paint from a formerly famous painter in pre-revolution Russia, she discovered that she really liked designing things. So after she graduated from high school, she decided to become an architect. And she was one of the few women who got into the Moscow Architectural Institute, so the main architectural university in the Soviet Union. And she was mainly accepted because the professors thought that her art was really good and they really liked her concepts. And so the thing is, how did she end up designing the space program? She married an engineer who was working for the space program. And at some point, she and her husband moved to, I have it somewhere here, to Korolev, or back then Kaliningrad, which is one of the secret cities of the space program. It's commonly known as the Star City. It's near Moscow. It's where all the cosmonauts and nowadays also astronauts go for training. And she was looking for a job, basically, because she was staying with her husband and they were in the secret city and she needed a job. And she got a job as the only architect at OKB-1, which was the experimental design bureau of Sergei Korolev, the main figure behind the Soviet space program at the time. And in the beginning, she was employed as an architect. So she did the usual things. It was basically a whole city, and a city needs planning. So she designed things like the cultural hall, normal apartment buildings for the workers. And yeah, then we got this. This is an American spacecraft. I think this is the Gemini. And after the first space flights by Yuri Gagarin, the space programs of the Soviet Union and the United States were competing to bring people into space for longer time periods. So this Gemini spacecraft was in space for 14 days. And you can kind of see the problem. You have two people in there for 14 days. And this small thing, they can't move, there's no space, it's really not a nice experience to be stuck into this thing for 2 weeks. So Sergei Korolev, the chief designer of the Soviet space program, decided that the cosmonauts needed a more normal life. So, yeah, that they could be more comfortable in space while doing their work. And they basically designed this, which we still see in use today, the Soyuz. The Soyuz is comprised of 3 capsules. You have the technical module in the back. You have in the middle, it's the landing capsule. It's the thing you usually see when the cosmonauts or astronauts return to Earth. That's the thing that returns. And the important thing for this talk is the thing on the left. That round thing is the orbital module. So the cosmonauts start in the landing capsule. And once they are in space, they can open a hatch between those two. And then they access the orbital module where they carry out their work, and which is also designed to include some leisure space so you can relax while you're in space. And that was Korolev's idea. So he sent his engineers to work because there were only engineers working at this design bureau. Also, I think almost all of them were male engineers. And they came up with something really terrible, which you probably know from open source software, because engineers are not really good at designing things sometimes, even though they think, well, this makes perfectly sense, this makes perfect sense, it's all there, but it's like terrible ergonomics and all that. So basically, there's no picture of what they came up with, but we are told it was very symmetrical and they painted everything bright red. And it's not really a relaxing atmosphere to spend like several weeks in space. So, Sergei Korolev got mad. He screamed at some people and he sent them to get him somebody who could do this job to design this thing properly. And that's when one of the people working for him in the bureau remembered that they already had an architect on their payroll in OKB-1. So there's no need to hire somebody else. So they got Galina Balashova and asked her to design the interior of the orbital module. And she says it was very hard for her because nobody really told her anything because everything was top secret. And she had to have her meetings in the staircase of the building because she was not allowed to go into the bureau itself because she did not have the security clearance. So she spent one weekend and she came up with this, which is very different from what the engineers had in mind. She describes the thought process as, well, you obviously need a divan, she calls it, to sit down, and you obviously need this cupboard thing on the other side to store your things and to have an ergonomical surface and, yeah. Now, this might look ridiculous, but Sergei Korolev, he really liked it. The only thing he didn't like was redesign. And so she made a redesign. This is version 2. This was almost approved, except for some small changes. We can see here, this is the final design, which is just some fabric choices and some rearrangements of things. And this was actually built in 1964, and this thing flew to space. Because it's a really good design, if you think about it. And the interesting thing is that nobody had done that before, because nobody had been to space before, except in those really tight and cramped space capsules. So there wasn't really any reference point to say, how do we actually design an interior for zero gravity? And her idea was this basic spherical design, that we have this cupboard where there's the instruments, where there's the equipment, and there's the food storage. And on the right side, we have this divan where the cosmonauts can lie down, and which also has storage space, and there's equipment hidden under it. And yeah, another important thing is we need a very balanced weight distribution, because yeah, you can't put all the weight on one side. So you have to have it kind of symmetrical, but not 100% symmetrical like the architect, the engineers did. And she was also thinking about the psychological effects. So you need to choose more friendly colors, and you need to stick to a color scheme. So for example, the floor is a different color than the ceiling, which you might think might not matter if you're in outer space and there's no gravity anyway. But your brain needs a reference point, and she figured it out pretty early on. NASA hasn't figured it out till today, I think. So as an anecdotal thing, there's a lot of cases of space sickness with astronauts. Space sickness is basically like seasickness, just the other way around. So your eyes detect movement, but your body says you're not really moving, something's wrong, so you get sick. And you puke, and that's not really good, because puke in zero gravity is not a nice thing to have. So she came up with this, and this is really helps, because you can orient yourself and the effects are less severe. And yeah, here's some more sketches. You also need to design for space requirements, if you have one cosmonaut, or if you have two cosmonauts or three cosmonauts. And those were her proposals for these things. So these are all original drawings that were reviewed by a design bureau and approved. So all of these went into production. Problem is, we don't really have a lot of things, a lot of pictures of the final result. I'm going to show you some later of the finished Soyuz capsules. But most of these were prototypes, and they did not really survive. Yes. So she did everything in watercolor. And this is a very basic design of the cupboard part, where you can see the instruments and the navigation equipment in the upper right corner. There's a drinking fountain to the left. There's storage space for the camera. And there's also storage space for the flight manuals. Yeah. This is the other thing with the radio and some controls and a lot of buttons. I don't really know what they all do. But yes, this thing went through several design iterations. Yeah. So this is basically the design of the first Soyuz spacecraft. It flew to space in that configuration, in that design. And yeah, Korolev really liked it, and this was like her first job designing a spacecraft, and they were not really sure if they needed her anymore, but they decided to rehire her for the second project, which is what came after the Soyuz. It's the Moon Orbital spacecraft, so the spacecraft that was designed to fly to the Moon. From 1964 to 1968, the whole project was abandoned in 68. Because the United States won the space race, they landed on the moon, Sergei Korolev died, the whole project didn't really work out. But the spacecraft itself already had a finalized design. There were finalized prototypes. And this time she was not just a consultant, but she was really hired and got a fixed position at OKB-1. As a senior engineer in the design team. Problem was that she was not really an engineer, but they did not have any design or architect positions in OKB-1. And it's pretty hard to just come up with a position like that if you have to stick to 5-year plans and all that. So she was hired as an engineer, and to make it seem less suspicious, she also had to do engineering, so she had to work and do the load calculations and things like that, and design position of instruments. So at that time, she was a full-time senior engineer working for the Soviet space program, and she stayed in that position until, I think, 91. So yeah, 40 years. These are some more pictures of the Moon Orbital spacecraft, where you can see that she stuck to the basic design that she came up with for the Soyuz, but the whole thing was a bit bigger and you needed to transport more equipment. Well, I'm just going to show you some pictures. This is another design proposal for the Moon Orbital spacecraft, which is a bit different. And the interesting thing is that these things look very 60s, because obviously interior design on Earth reflected interior design in space. And yeah, she worked alone on this because she was the only architect in the whole thing. And she had a lot of freedom in what she did. In her words, a nice thing about the job was that none of the engineers didn't really understand what the hell she was doing there. So they didn't really interfere, because to them it was irrelevant and they didn't really think what she did was important at all. In their mind, she only had to select colors. So she says the engineers were always really mystified when she came to them and asked, how are the dimensions of the whole thing? What do you have in mind? What equipment do we need to put in there? Because they figured, oh, she's just doing the carpet in the thing and nothing else matters. While in fact, she was designing the position of everything, the ergonomics of everything. So she had a lot of freedom. Engineers still had the last word when it came to technical aspects, because that's their job. But apart from that, she was pretty free to do how she pleased. And yeah, again, this is another sketch for the Moon Orbital spacecraft. So because we have no gravity, she designed this whole thing without a clear floor and ceiling, so you can access most things from both sides, no matter if you're like from this viewpoint upside down. But still, there was this distinct color scheme, so you always knew what way you were looking. And yeah, this was, oh no, that's the wrong one. Sorry. Yeah, this was the Moon Orbital spacecraft. The prototype was built, the final thing was never built, obviously, because the Soviets never made it to the moon. And yeah, after that she was rehired, she stayed in the position and got a new project. The new project was the Soyuz T, which is the second generation of the Soyuz. Which you can see here. Again, she stuck to the basic design. Again, with the cupboard thing. She calls it a cupboard, it's just her words, and the divan on the other side. And again, with a very clear color scheme. And yeah, she was also in charge of choosing the materials. So the whole thing is padded in fabric, so that if you hit your head, it's soft and not just hard metal. And so part of the job also included calling all the fabric factories around the Soviet Union to find a matching fabric that had to be non-flammable, non-toxic, so B1 for the people who did build up here. And yeah, also she decided to use enamel for the metal surfaces, because it cleans up easier and it's a more pleasant design. And yeah, in her words, the engineers did never consider that cosmonauts really need to sleep in space and might need this divan, or that they need a cupboard to store things. To them, it was just this technical thing of, okay, we build a spacecraft, it can fly to space, that's all we need. We don't really need ergonomics, we don't really need storage space. But she was working closely with the... Did I skip one? Yeah. She was working closely with the cosmonauts. So every time the cosmonauts returned from space, she would talk to them and ask them, were there any problems with the things? Is there anything we could do better? One example is this divan thing. So it's built for the cosmonauts to sleep on, because even if you're in space, just floating around while sleeping is not very good, because you will eventually hit a wall or something and it's not very comfortable. So the first iteration of the divan was very rough fabric that Velcro would stick on. So the cosmonauts had sewn Velcro pads into their spacesuits, and they could just lie down and they would stick to the divan. Yeah, the cosmonauts that came back from that first space flight told her that, yeah, it was nice, but we had some problems because we lost our pants, because the pants stuck really good to the Velcro. And so the second design iteration was with just normal belts. So you would lie down and put a belt over yourself so you wouldn't float around. Yeah, and also she designed the whole interior thing. So, for example, also the ways to how can we affix the cable covers in there, and how do we affix the fabric? The engineers at first just glued the fabric down all around, and she came up with a way to make that whole thing easier and lighter by just using tape. So she made the Soyuz space module 9 kilograms lighter just by coming up with a better way to affix the fabric, which would have given her a lot of money because all the engineers were promised a lot of money if they could make this thing lighter, and she made it 9 kilograms lighter, but she never got that money because the engineers were like, well, we did that. She's just an architect. She's not the engineer. It was our idea. So it's just a basic sexism thing that we also had in the Soviet space industry in the 60s. This is the final design for the Soyuz T. And again, this thing went to space, looks exactly like that. Afterwards, she was also hired to do the landing module, so not just the orbital module she did before. Same thing, she came up with a basic design with these with a improved design for the bucket seats, so they already had the bucket seats, but the color scheme and the ergonomics and arrangement of the instruments are all her work, and it's still pretty much used in the same way today. Just gonna go on here. This is something special. This is the Soyuz Apollo orbital module. There were several missions where Soviet space crews and American space crews met in space and docked their vehicles together, and it was a pretty big thing for Cold War relationships when cosmonauts and astronauts would shake hands in outer space. So this needed some design changes because the whole thing was going to be broadcast live from TV. So there were a lot of things were changed to have better lighting and to have better cameras in there. And also the colors were changed because the first design was with red colors, but that did not really look good on the camera. So they changed the fabric to green. And as she recalled, she was really proud when Alexei Leonov, the famous Soviet cosmonaut. He was the first person to take a spacewalk, and he was also the commander of the first Soyuz Apollo mission. And when he came back, he gave an interview in Moscow, and he told the newspapers that, well, now that I've seen the Apollo spacecraft, and I really like it, but you know, I just think our Soyuz spacecraft is really, really way better. It's so much more structured. It's so wonderfully thought out. And she was really proud of that because he was this famous cosmonaut praising her work and saying that it's so much better than the Apollo. So now we're getting to the pictures of the real thing. This is Galina Balashova in the finished Soyuz Apollo orbital module. And she did a lot of work in those modules. She had to test everything out before it went to space because it's really not good if you find bugs in your design while you're in outer space. And like I told you, she also listened to the feedback from the cosmonauts. They were complaining about other things besides the thing with losing their pants. There were problems with the toilet. It was really uncomfortable because you basically have a small cupboard compartment down there where there's this suction device because you don't want pee floating around in space. That's really not nice. And the cosmonaut said it was really uncomfortable, so she designed that also, like redesigned it. And she added mosquito nets because cosmonauts wished for mosquito nets because small things would float around in space and hit you in the head, which is not nice. And also a better, they wished for a better place for to store documents like flight manuals and technical documents, because the original place was okay, but not really good to reach if you need some book really fast because you're having a situation. Yeah, this is her testing out a new belt system for keeping your pants on in space. Also, you have to keep a lot of things in mind, so it might seem like a simple job, but it's not. You also have to choose your materials in a way that no condensate can form, because the water from your breath will eventually condensate somewhere, and it's really not good if it happens in some electrical modules while you're in outer space. The other thing is that she also tried to choose colors that would make a friendly impression on the cosmonauts. So this is a nice place. I want to be in this place. Not everything clinical white or bright red. Yes. Now we're getting to something that's still in space, that's still designed by here. This is one of the first sketches for the Mir core module for the Mir space station. From 1967 to 1987, she was on the project to design the original Salyut space stations. And this thing was mostly designed by engineers, and she just got to this... Yeah, this thing was designed by her. She also did the work for the Buran, which is the Soviet equivalent to the Space Shuttle program. And for that one, she only did the fabric and color choice, but for the Mir, she did a lot of things. And again, to compare to NASA's work, at the same time, the first Salyut space stations went into service, the NASA had Skylab, and Skylab didn't have any architects. They thought about hiring some, but there was critique from the astronauts, because the astronauts were like, we don't need architects in our space program, we don't want them. What the hell is wrong with you? So they did not hire any architects. And yeah, just gonna... quality is really bad, I think, but... This is the interior of the Mir core module. She decided to... create two very distinct working spaces in this module. So this is the salon, as she called it, which is more like the area to hang out in, to eat, to do your normal life stuff while you're in space. And so she chose a blue and green color scheme to have a pretty warm color scheme for recreation areas. And this is the other part of the station. This is the work area. This is more of a blue color scheme because, so you can focus while you're working. And her first idea was that she wanted way more windows in this thing, but the engineers did not really like that because there are two ways you can design this core module, and one would have been with the way it was designed with this longitudinal axis. The other one would have been to make basically several floors of it, but it would have been really impractical to build. But if that way would have been chosen, you would have been able to make windows on the outside. But yeah, so the final design just got some very small windows. And yeah, she also had this engineering alibi job where she also had to do engineering to, so she could stay in her position as a senior engineer. So for example, she did she designed the position of the stabilizers, which is the picture you see on the left, so that the space station would be stabilized while in outer space. And another thing she did, because she was the only artist and architect working for the space program, she also did the typography design for the whole thing. So whenever you've seen a Soviet flag on something, the placement was carefully chosen by her on the Soyuz capsules, on the Mir, on the Buran. And this, for example, is a typography of the Buran program. And another thing that she did was she did these watercolor paintings, because she used to do watercolor paintings in her free time. And she decided that the cosmonauts would need something to remind them of their home. So each Soyuz spacecraft and also the Salyut stations had a small watercolor painting by her in a small frame on the wall somewhere, so you could look at it and remember how nice it was back home in the Soviet Union. And yeah, there were landscapes, there were snowflakes, and the Black Sea. And she was the first artist who got her pictures to outer space, which is quite an achievement. Another part of her work included the flight pennants for commemoration of the space missions, because again, she was the only architect, the only artist that worked for the space program that already had all the security clearance, that knew what was going on. And also they didn't really want to hire anybody else because we already have one, so she can do everything. So she also did these for 40 years, and she also did logos for the missions. This is the Soyuz Apollo logo, which was got really famous and was used a lot for a lot of merchandise. She's still a bit bitter about that because the administration forced her to sign over the rights to the administration, because it's socialism after all, and we shouldn't have like one artist get all the praise for this. This is obviously it's a community thing. Which in the end led to some American guy claiming the copyright and getting a lot of money for it, and her getting nothing. Here we have some more flight pennants for different intercosmos things, so for cooperation between Japan and the Soviet Union, and one for the Mir space station, one for the Salyut. And I'm going to end this thing with some pictures from the ISS, because you can see a clear difference here, because this is the interior of the Zvezda module on the ISS. Even though she was forced into retirement after the collapse of the Soviet Union, so in, I think, 91, because Roscosmos didn't want to keep her on the payroll, her design still made it to the ISS, because the first module of the ISS was a repurposed backup module for the Mir. So she still designed that one, which you can also clearly see, even though it's like pretty cramped after all these years, you can still see there's a distinct color scheme with the floor. It's not really a floor because you're in outer space, but the one part being a different color than the ceiling, and the walls having a distinct color thing. Here's another picture of the other side of the module. Again, you can see there's a clear color scheme going on. And now for comparison, this is the ISS Destiny module designed by NASA, where people often get space sickness because, it's way harder to orient yourself in this. So yeah, she worked for the program for 40 years and her designs are still in use. And because she was the first to ever do something like that, and she came up with a lot of really good stuff that we still use for the Soyuz, for the Mir, for basically everything we designed today for outer space, still is inspired by her. And I'm just gonna end this with a quote by her. So she's saying she's living in a prefab building, or Plattenbau as you call it in Germany. And she says it's basically the same thing as living in the Mir or the ISS, because, yeah, it's designed following technical requirements set out by engineers, but what you do with it and how you decorate your interior and how you make the most of it, this is done by artists. So, yeah, the Mir space station and her living room basically have something in common. Yeah. That's my talk. Thank you for listening.
So thank you for your talk. Are there any questions? Ah, over there.
I can't see anything, there's bright light, but
is there maybe an ability to actually witness what one of those divan might have looked like in real life on this very area here?
Yeah, we built one. So if you're interested, we built a replica based on original designs. It's over there at Chaos Zone. It's not really the same thing, but we try to stick to the original designs somewhat, so that this achievement can be more visible even at Congress. Yeah. Any more questions? I have a really bright light in my face. I can't see anything.
Hi. I was wondering, you said because of physiological things that it was still some like quite Earth-centric. So you had a floor, you had a ceiling, and it was everything built like also to be used in gravity. You had a divan which was flattened out. Wasn't it a? And it seemed for me, in space where you don't have gravity, so where you could use all surfaces more, it seemed quite a big loss of space to not use it. So is this like this space sickness thing, so such a big thing that you can't say, okay, we can also put some panels on the ceiling or stuff like this?
Yes, so it was done more for psychological purposes, so you don't get disoriented. So yeah, I mean, some of the things are designed to be used in any direction, basically, but the basic design was purposely made to be, yeah, kind of like gravity-centric, like you said. It was not used in gravity because the orbital modules would only be accessed once the spacecraft was in outer space. But yeah, mostly psychological reasons, I guess.
One other question. Is there some kind of style guide or design guide where her essence is brought into for current development of spacecraft or something like that? Some heritage of her?
Not really. The problem is that all this work was like state secret till the collapse of the Soviet Union. So it's really hard to find anything on it. There was an exhibition, I think, 6 or 7 years ago. And you can get a catalog from the exhibition, which has lots of original drawings in better quality than this presentation, and also a very long interview with her and her recollections as her time working there. So it's the closest thing you can get, I think.
Yeah. Any more questions?
Hello?
Oh, wonderful. Is there a reason why the NASA didn't adapt the Soviet design language for the newer spacecraft?
It's kind of complicated. One of the main reasons is that the Soviet space program and the US space program had one fundamental difference. So most of the astronauts of the US space program came from military backgrounds and were test pilots before, something like that. And they always wanted to have absolute control. So like you maybe saw on the picture of the Gemini spacecraft I had, there's really a lots of controls and levers and everything, while the Soyuz has way less. And the difference is that NASA spacecraft are really designed that you have to do everything by hand, while Soviet spacecraft were designed that most of the things are really automated, so the cosmonauts can't really do that much. Of course, there are emergency things they can do if something goes wrong, but the basic principle is that almost everything from start to re-entry is automated and you don't really do a lot. And the astronauts never really liked that. NASA tried at some point to do it more automated, because of course you can also make a lot of mistakes if you have to do everything manually. And some mistakes happened where they were like almost disasters because somebody forgot to push this switch or close this valve, which would happen automatically in the Soyuz modules, which is also one of the reasons why the Soyuz has a better safety record. But the astronauts of the US program are really skeptical about this whole we need to automate it thing. So they also are very, very skeptical about letting artists or architects work on this, because to them everything has to be very, very engineered and mechanical, and like, yeah, no art, no covers for your cables, no homely feeling in space, but just this more military thing. So if it looks like a fighter jet, they feel fine. If it looks like a nice place to stay for 2 weeks, they are like uncomfortable because I don't know where that cable is going or things like that. So I think it's partly because of this psychological reason. So NASA tried to hire architects at some point in the early 90s again, I think. But again, there was really no support in the structures because the astronauts think, no, we don't need that. We are fine, we're doing fine.
Thank you very much.
Hello. The space shuttle was very similar in Soviet Union and America, from at least from the outside. I think the Soviets had something very similar. Were the interiors very different then? Because the Soviets have a different approach?
Probably the problem is that we don't really have any interiors to look at, because the final version of the Buran was never built. So there were some flight test versions and one version that made one automated space flight, but they never really finished the interior for the thing. So we're not really sure what it's supposed to look like. I couldn't find any pictures of it. So Galina Balashova said that she did not do that much for it. It was mostly designed by engineers, and she just chose the color scheme for the whole thing.
I would be curious to know how the, like, is this whole topic, like the interior design and being a bit more conscious and aware, is this something that is nowadays caught up by the private firms that are building spacecraft and are designing spacecraft, like SpaceX and the others, also on the American side of things, let's say? Are they considering this? Are they referencing this? You know, is there a bit of a shift?
I don't really know about that. I haven't really checked. I really hope they do. But my guess would be they probably don't, because they are engineers, and if it works, it works. No need for it to be comfortable. But I guess they are going to do something if they want to do it like for tourists or for the public, because then you can't really have this fighter jet interior they had in the NASA program. But I don't really know. I'm sorry.
So I don't see any more questions. So thank you very much, Aurora. It was a really nice talk, and give her a warm applause.